You're listening to The Voice of Russia in London with me, Juliet Spare. Around 140 million girls and women worldwide are living with the consequences of female genital mutilation, FGM. According to the World Health Organization, it's a painful and traumatic procedure, a danger to unborn children, and possesses absolutely no health benefits and is a violation of the human rights of girls and women. FGM, on the other hand, is considered by its practitioners to be an essential part of raising a girl properly. Girls are regarded as having been cleansed by the removal of male body parts. It ensures premarital virginity and inhibits extramarital sex. Now, it's estimated 92 million girls have had their genitals mutilated in Africa. Here in the UK, around 20,000 children in England and Wales and about the same number in France are deemed at risk every year from FGM, despite the practice being illegal. But whereas some 100 parents and practitioners of FGM have been convicted in France, there's never been a single prosecution here in the UK. Joining me around the table to discuss female genital mutilation is the founder of anti-FGM charity 28 Too Many, Anne-Marie Wilson, and Dr. Comfort Mormore, a specialist midwife in FGM and public health from Guy's and St Thomas's Hospital in London. And taking part in our discussion on the phone is Nimco Ali, co-founder and director of Daughters of Eve, a non-profit organisation set up by women from FGM practicing communities working to protect girls and young women. And from Berlin, rapper and singer from Senegal, hip-hop artist Sister Far, who campaigns to end the mutilation of girls. First of all, I'd like to start with you, Dr. Mormore. What scale are we talking about when we talk about FGM?
It is a big scale here in the UK. As you've rightly said, it's about 140 million girls worldwide have been through FGM, and this figure is increasing every year according to the World Health Organization and according to United Nations. So it is a big problem.
And how has the practice of FGM changed, perhaps, since the law was introduced in the mid-90s? Have you seen more women in your ward?
I guess with immigration, obviously, one need to look at immigration, people migrating from different parts of Africa coming here or from the practicing community. Yes, it has increased. But what we have noticed in the last 10 years or within the last 7 years, the attitude are changing gradually, especially among the younger generations who are now speaking out, who are now coming out and say, enough is enough. We don't want this to happen anymore. So in that sense, things are changing, but we still have the older generation who still hang on to their beliefs and their cultural values.
Nimco, you are a survivor of FGM. I understand it happened to you when you were 7 years old. Can you explain the process a little bit to us, if it's comfortable for you?
Well, yeah, I am a survivor, and I'm also an activist that speaks out for those young people that Comfort was talking about, the fact that there are more and more young people coming forward. And that is essentially how it was with me as well. It's the fact that I grew up in the UK, I lived here, but we went on holiday to Somalia, and I had my FGM there. And it was something which, for me, I knew as a seven-year-old what was completely wrong, because in my life there was nothing else that was as abhorrent as that was happening. So there wasn't that cultural context which people keep putting it into. And I came back to the UK and I told my teacher, and she told me that, oh, it was a cultural thing that happens and it's fine. And I was just thinking, it's not fine. And then growing up, the more I saw young people that were trying to speak out and everybody was ignoring them, that's where, in the end, myself and my other co-founders ended up starting Daughters of Eve in order to have their voices heard, and trying to push for the fact that these young people are coming forward, but we need to protect them, and we as the adults have a duty of responsibility to their safety.
What sort of scale of FGM is taking place in the UK
Well, let's just say I grew up in a capital city of Wales, in Cardiff, and I didn't meet anybody that hadn't gone through FGM from a largest FGM practicing communities until I was about 23, and that was only because that girl had grown up in Sweden. So all my everybody that I know from my age range has had an FGM, and the catalyst that essentially started me on this process of actually speaking about my experience was in 2007. I was invited to a local academy to come speak to a group of girls about careers and so on, and that essentially led on to them talking about FGM. And there was 13 girls, all EU born, so either born in the UK, Sweden, Holland, so on. And out of the 13, 12 of those girls had undergone FGM. But nothing was being done at the time, and everybody was talking about it. This is an immigration issue. This was an issue that women were coming in cut, as opposed to the fact that the girls were being taken away or were being mutilated in the UK. So numbers, I can't say, because we have the 22,000 girls that are at risk, but there's more than 22,000 girls, because the recent research that was done in London alone said that 7,000 children are born to women who've undergone FGM every year in London alone. So if you take half of those as being girls, then the 22,000 girls are more than in London alone that are at risk of FGM.
Sister Far, you grew up in Senegal and sort of turned to rap, and you know, you've probably tackled FGM in a more cultural way back at within your own community. Can you describe to us, firstly, the scale of FGM for people who around the world don't really understand it or don't know it, and what it means for community to have the practice done, and for women?
Yeah, for that all, I would like to say thank you for the invitation. Yes, I come from in the south of Senegal, it's Casamance, and then from the statistic, it said that 89% of girls are cut, and just like some miles from Gigancho, like Kolda, it's like 94% of the girls like infibulated. And then where I come from, for example, if you are not cut, then they consider you as a solima. We call those girls solima. Solima mean someone who's dirty, who's impure person. And if you are solima in my community, you cannot get married there, you cannot cook food for people, you cannot greet old people, you will not invite, whether it's like ceremonies or deeds or some kind of like a thing that can like bring people together, you will not invite. There is many places that you are not really allowed to cross because you still carry your clitoris, and then you cannot find a husband, you just like worse than an animal. And then of course, if we just if I just step back before, like after have been cut, in the Jolas community, we have another ceremony calling Gasus. And if you're not cut from the Enyaka, you are not allowed to participate in the Gasus. And Gasus is one of the most important ceremony in the Jola communities. It's just like a kind of initiation, like ceremony who prepare the girls to become a woman, to be like ready to get married and to be like assisting your own community, to be like sharing all things from your community. And of course, it's a little bit like strange when I try to say it like this, most of the mother who's like ignorant, most of them just decide to cut their child, their girls, because they want to protect them. Because if they are not, which mother can be like, you know, support to see your own child like outcast, like treating as an animal in her own community? Then it's happened many times that a lot of mothers don't want to do it, but they don't have choice.
Do you take on your music as a kind of role to help this and speak to the second generation that Comfort mentioned, that are the ones who will be able to perhaps change this practice?
Yeah, as an artist, I just see in Africa how music have a big impact to really like to bring people together, and then to have like a big muscle of people. And then for me, the as we use the hip hop, it's a kind of like music that we use for revendication. And it was as an victim myself, I was just thinking like a lot of NGOs are doing great job in Africa. Lots of NGOs, and then I just have been there in May with a big NGO, a small NGOs from the UK calling Orchid. Maybe you don't know it, but they really work with me as a partner. We work together in Senegal, and we have been like, we did a big tour, And then what we were doing was going to the school, because it was very hard to get the authorization to get really like in the school and the classroom to talk with the children, because most of the director was saying, no, we don't know how the parent will react if they know that we allow you to talk about, he said, sexuality in the classroom. But we were not talking about sexuality, we were talking about human rights. And then we were there with some ORCID members, Rudy Taylor, with Birgit from Sweden, with my own musician from Germany. We were there and we was going classroom after classroom. We were talking about the topic because it was very important to get involved those young girls and boys who will be soon mothers and fathers to know already that it's their life, it's the right for their own children to grow up with their own body. And then we just see that it was really great job to really try to reach the young people. Because after all activities we have done, it was like concert, it was like workshop, we invited the children to make theater about the topic, but with lot of respect, we don't even mention the word mutilation, we just say cutting, do not shock the communities, and then we invite the children to really discuss and to tell us their own experience have been like cut or not cut in their own communities. We just see that like in one village called Chonkesil, there was two or three girls who were not cut because they did not grow up there, and they was really telling in front of their own friends the way that they treat them, that they don't like it. But today we are really happy and proud to see Sister Far saying this, bringing this message, because we know that our parents did write to us to not cut us. And then actually it's happened in many villages actually right now that they have some activities, cultural activities, and they bring the topic of female genital cutting inside because of our project. Then for me it's something really to take very positive if we try to get the young people involved in this case, if we really would like to abolish it in the next years.
You're listening to The Voice of Russia in London with me, Juliet Spare. We're discussing the practice of FGM. Dr. Comfort Mormore is a specialist midwife in FGM and public health at Guy's and St. Thomas's Hospital in London. Nimco Ali is the co-founder and director of charity Daughter of Eve, a support network set up for women from FGM practicing communities. Hip-hop artist from Senegal, Sister Far, campaigns to end the cutting of girls in Africa through music. And Anne-Marie Wilson founded anti-FGM charity 28 Too Many. Anne-Marie, can you tell us about your work?
Yes, well, I founded this charity having worked in Africa since 2001 as a volunteer capacity builder working in different communities. And it was my personal experience of meeting women in Africa that I wanted to actually make a difference myself. I met a little girl who at 10 years old had already had FGM, which is what we use as the terminology for international work, but of course in her community it would have a local name. She'd been cut at 5, she was raped and orphaned at 10, and fell pregnant from that rape. And at 10 years old she birthed her baby, but she was left 7 months pregnant with obstructed labour. Had she not come to our clinic, she would have died in labour. So that was a life-changing moment for me. So I gave up my business and decided to look around and see what else could be done. But there really was very little working internationally to bring communities together, to share knowledge of best practice. I worked a few years later in a Somali refugee camp where I realised just doing my... I did a degree in cross-cultural studies and actually realised in doing that study I knew more than the people who'd been running the gender-based violence unit for about 8 to 10 years, and thought this is crazy that the knowledge isn't shared internationally. So we set about making a charity that would just share knowledge globally on all best practice and all information, all academia and facts and figures for each country. So firstly, we could benchmark them at one time, once and for all, and then we could actually see what practices and progress was being made to make a difference.
And is there any community, country that kind of has the best practice yet?
Well, I think there are a number. I think that it's easy to think one country is best, but there's certainly alternative rites of practice which tend to happen to a large extent in some of East Africa, but also in some of West Africa as well. And they are quite simply what they say, an alternative rite of passage. It might be a ceremony that avoids cutting and bodily harm. It might be an initiation process that involves teaching young women, firstly, what will happen to them, because they don't normally know that, and secondly, turning them into advocates for their own country so they become ambassadors for the next generation. There's another practice, which is a community enablement, which we've already been discussing some of the practices from that. And that will actually mean that instead of a group, a village that might have intermarried its girls to the boys from the next village, in simple terms, they actually can convert the one village and the other intermarrying villages to actually choose to all abandon FGM at one time. So that a bit like I did my study and just had an academic paper published a week or so ago on the parallels of ending foot binding, which went on for 1,000 years but was eradicated in 16 years. And if you could have the same parallel in anti-FGM work, that it, in three generations or so, the same could happen, that's practice gone on for 2,000 years. So that gave me hope to see that actually change can happen. But I think what it will take is a girl to not be cut herself, to not be cut when she, to not cut her daughter when she's a mother, and to then not cut her granddaughter or be, work as a circumciser for the third generation, a couple of generations for good measure. But I think it could take realistically 30 to 50 years to for world abandonment.
World abandonment, obviously, and that's in accordance to the World Health Organization's guidelines on FGM. But we're talking about changing 2,000 to 3,000 years worth of cultural behaviour. Comfort, how easy is that going to be in medical practice?
I guess we have to be realistic, as I always say to people, to change attitude and mindset will take a long time. But saying that, we need to put all our efforts, all our hope, because like you rightly said, Anne Marie, change can happen with hope. I guess that's why we're all campaigning, that's why we're all activists, and that's why we're working with young women and older generation as well. Things will change, but it will take a long time. Definitely.
I'd like to come to you now, Nimco. Obviously, I mentioned the conviction rate in France compared to the UK, and we've heard from Anne-Marie with her work in Africa, East and West, and Comfort, who works in London. You've obviously worked with girls in Bristol and Cardiff.
And London, yeah.
And London. Is there a sense of tolerance in the UK?
It is. It's kind of like the understanding that we have around FGM. So again, let me. One of the things that was just said was comparing FGM to the ending of foot binding, and we seem to think of FGM as a single issue that doesn't actually happen within the framework of the violence against women, which that's where it sits, and the fact that foot binding wasn't eradicated because there was respect for women's rights or women's humanity was the fact that the Communism Party wanted women in the fields. So essentially for me, what really stops girls from being protected for FGM and women being empowered is that we see it as a separate issue. And that's what's happening, is people have put it in this cultural cul-de-sac where it's FGM, we need to eradicate it, we need to, like, you know, they talk about it as a way of vaccinating people by changing their minds to not do FGM without actually seeing what it is that we owe a duty to young people and children to protect them from the abuses that they face. So what's happening in the UK is the fact that those that want to carry on FGM have been given the platforms in order to eradicate FGM, which is quite ridiculous. So what's just happened is that they've put words around culture, faith, and all these things around it, and everybody's just too scared to address the issue. And that's what's happening in the UK. But in France, it's not happened. And the fact that there is not a specific law in France where FGM is prosecuted against, but it's there within the criminal offences. So essentially for me, is the fact that we need to bring FGM back into the mainstream, and we need to look at it for the child abuse that that it is, and stop segregating all the time, because that's where the problem is. When we segregate it and we think that there's a special way to address it, when it's not, we just need to follow the safeguarding procedures that are out there and protect children.
You're listening to The Voice of Russia in London with me, Juliet Spare, where we're discussing the practice of female genital mutilation. I'm joined by Nimco Ali, the co-founder and director of charity Daughter of Eve, a support network set up for women from FGM practicing communities. Hip-hop artist from Senegal, Sister Far, who campaigns to end the cutting of girls in Africa. Anne-Marie Wilson, who founded anti-FMG charity 28 Too Many. And Dr. Comfort Mormor, who's a specialist midwife in FGM and public health at Guy's and St. Thomas's Hospital in London.
We need to start looking at safeguarding issues Most of the young women, they get really trapped because on one hand we're saying it's a culture, it's a tradition, and on the other hand they want to belong to the new culture and they really get trapped. So how or what are the government doing in terms of safeguarding these young women or these girls who've been through FGM? So again, I will really ask the government, obviously. I know they then started doing something or getting involved, but we need more support from the government. We need more support from the professionals as well in terms of knowing where to signpost girls who need help too. At the moment, I'm looking at a survey, I'm looking at the attitude and knowledge among general practitioners, which from my own experience of running the African Well Women's Clinic is kind of nil, if you like, because most of the girls that come to me will say to me, Comfort, I went to my GP, they didn't know where to refer me to, which is really sad because there's so many clinics now out in UK where the GP should be referring girls or signposting girls to, and this is not happening. So in terms of professional support, that is lacking, as well as government support, I'll say, in terms of safeguarding girls.
If a young girl goes to a GP and says, what's happened, what's the first port of call then? Is it medical, you know, cosmetic approach, like France, or do we go to the more holistic approach or the mental health route? Which one would be first? And for those of you who've had FGM, tell me now, what do you think, when you were seven, what should have been done?
And that's what I mean. When I was seven, the only thing that should have been done is the fact that to make sure that I didn't have any other sisters and protect and actually put in a framework to ensure that I was safe. And that's the first thing that needs to be done if any young woman comes forward, is to ensure that she is safe. And then we deal with the health and the psychological issues that she is facing. And sadly, there has been a lot done in terms of, or there are services such as Comfort's Clinic and so on around the physical needs of women, but there is nothing done for the psychological and the psychosexual needs of young women. And that is predominantly the main issue that we face. And again, a lot of the clinics that have been set up have also been titled as African Well Women Clinics. These girls are more British than they are African, so it's about actually treating the individual as opposed to treating the community and the cause of the issue as what's been aimed at the moment. But for me, it's actually looking at safety and protection, and what's been quite key is that we've met with World Autism, we have met with the NSPCC recently, and we've got another meeting today, and they're very keen on getting FGM onto their agenda, because this is what we need to do. We need to mainstream it so everybody understands that it can happen to girls from across the world, because there are larger practicing communities, there are larger affected communities. But our daughters of Eve, because we haven't put a culture or a colour or a faith around the subject, we've had girls that have come forward that are white Caucasian girls who've had type 3 FGM because their parents were unhappy about their sexuality. So what we need to understand is that the root of FGM is patriarchy, and it's women's oppression that is keeping FGM going. So we can't keep talking about it as though we're going to try to educate women without empowering women and giving them political roles where they can actually stand up and actually change things from the top.
Anne-Marie Wilson. I think that's true, a lot of what's already been said. I think we also advise Barnardos, who are often sending families back home to different countries in Africa. What we're doing at the moment is creating a model of change that's got a lot of these different aspects, because FGM sits alongside other practices like forced marriage and other domestic violence and abuse, sexual violence issues. We're actually putting together tools and research so that we can share that practice across all the agencies that need that. And we also work with the government and the Foreign Commonwealth Office, DFID, the Home Office, Department of Health and Education, because it's a multi-agency solution that's needed. We also find that by training academics and schools and other groups that can be an agent for change, whether it's men or faith-based groups, whether Islamic or Christian or Jewish or any of the practicing communities, we can actually make a difference. And in terms of things like the the FGM type issues that, that happen with FGM practicing communities, or the labiaplasty issues of so-called cosmetic surgery. I think what we need to do there, I mean, as a psychologist, what I'm interested in is the mental health issues of those individuals, where actually we need to be giving psychological support about people to being comfortable with their body. It's really a body dysmorphic issue, and actually we need to be addressing that and the implications of the pornography industry, where often young men look at pornography models who have had their body anatomically changed by surgery, who then think that that is normal, and then don't think that their girlfriends are normal, and put pressure on their girlfriends to have surgery, who often go along with their parents presenting on the NHS for surgery, which is just not required. And I think we need to be very careful that the pressure to be politically correct for traditional FGM practicing community, or young Caucasian girls who want to appear a different body, we have to be very careful not to be so sensitive to their needs that we actually end up doing unnecessary surgery, which is actually just creating a new problem where we're trying to eradicate an old one.
Well, just explain for me again the new surgery to eradicate the old one.
There hasn't been a demand for labiaplasty for 15-year-old Caucasian girls. It's a new demand come up from the pornography industry, really. If young boys are now getting access to porn earlier because of smartphones at 15, 16 and younger, they're seeing the models who have an altered physiology from cosmetic surgery, and then they say that that's what a girl should look like. And if their girl doesn't look like that, instead of them accepting their girlfriend, every girl is different, just like breasts are different, genitals are different, then the girls are going off for surgery, which is completely unnecessary. So while we're all four of us on this panel are actively anti-FGM, if we see that beginning to reduce, which it is in certain pockets, another problem is coming up, which is another cultural practice. And I think we're just, you know, creating new problems, really. So we need to go on those two angles at the same time.
I was going to say that labiaplasty is a growing issue, and it's something that we as a feminist organisation and working with UK Fair Minister have always said that it's exactly the same thing, that a cut by every by you know, the name is still a cut, and it's still at the hands of altering women's bodies for men's ideals of what women should look like.
Comfort, I did see you agreeing with a lot of what Anne-Marie said. Just a final word from you.
Well, I know. Why I'm nodding is that, yes, we do see lots of women now. I guess it's the pressure. Pressure has rightly been said that men are now demanding for women to have a different type of vagina and all that. So is the pressure. And what are we as activists doing to empower ourselves and to say, no, this is what we want for ourselves? And can I just quickly say, we are at the moment planning to do a Nollywood film on FGM to raise awareness. So whoever wants to join in this project, please contact me. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all my guests today for joining me, Juliet Sparrow, on The Voice of Russia in London, talking about female genital mutilation. Founder and director of Daughters of Eve, a non-profit organisation set up by women from FGM practicing communities working to protect girls and young women. And from Berlin, rapper and singer from Senegal, hip-hop artist Sister Far, who campaigns to end the mutilation of girls. First of all, I'd like to start with you, Dr. Mormor. What scale are we talking about when we talk about FGM?
It is a big scale here in the UK. As you've rightly said, it's about 140 million girls worldwide have been through FGM, and this figure is increasing every year according to the World Health Organization and according to United Nations. So it is a big problem.
And how has the practice of FGM changed, perhaps, since the law was introduced in the mid-90s? Have you process a little bit to us, if it's comfortable for you?
Well, yeah, I am a survivor, and I'm also an activist that speaks out for those young people that Comfort was talking about, the fact that there are more and more young people coming forward, and that is essentially how it was with me as well. It's the fact that I grew up in the UK, I lived here, but we went on holiday to Somalia, and I had my FGM there. And it was something which, for me, I knew as a seven-year-old what was completely wrong, because in my life there was nothing else that was as abhorrent as that was happening. So there wasn't that cultural context which people keep putting it into. And I came back to the UK, and I told my teacher, and she told me that, oh, it was a cultural thing that happens, and it's fine. And I was just thinking, it's not fine. And then growing up, the more I saw young people that were trying to speak out.
Body parts. It ensures premarital virginity and inhibits extramarital sex. Now, it's estimated 92 million girls have had their genitals mutilated in Africa. Here in the UK, around 20,000 children in England and Wales, and about the same number in France, are deemed at risk every year from FGM, despite the practice being illegal. But whereas some 100 parents and practitioners of FGM have been convicted in France, there's never been a single prosecution here in the UK. Joining me around the table to discuss female genital mutilation is the founder of anti-FGM charity 28 Too Many, Anne-Marie Wilson, and Dr. Comfort Mormor, a specialist midwife in FGM and public health from Guy's and St Thomas's Hospital in London. And taking part in our discussion on the phone is Nimco Ali, You're listening to The Voice of Russia in London with me, Juliet Spare. Around 140 million girls and women worldwide are living with the consequences of female genital mutilation, FGM. According to the World Health Organization, it's a painful and traumatic procedure, a danger to unborn children, and possesses absolutely no health benefits, and is a violation of the human rights of girls and women. FGM, on the other hand, is considered by its practitioners to be an essential part of raising a girl properly. Girls are regarded as having been cleansed by the removal of male. You've seen more women in your ward?
I guess with immigration, obviously, one need to look at immigration, people migrating from different parts of Africa coming here or from the practicing community. Yes, it has increased. But what we have noticed in the last 10 years or within the last 7 years, the attitude are changing gradually, especially among the younger generations who are now speaking out, who are now coming out and say, enough is enough. We don't want this to happen anymore. So in that sense, things are changing, but we still have the older generation who still hang on to their beliefs and their cultural values.
Nimco, you are a survivor of FGM. I understand it happened to you when you were 7 years old. Can you explain